Let's pray. Dear God, I just want to thank you for this time that we have together, and I pray that you would speak through Eli and that we would all have ears to listen. In your name I pray, amen.
All right, first of all, I just want to thank Matt for allowing me to do this, to get a good start for my ministry and what God would have do through my life. I look around and I pretty much know all of you, so that kind of helps me out. Don't have to worry as much. So, my passage tonight is James 4 through 10, if you want to turn there. So, we should have some statistics up here about our love for the world. Okay, there it is. Cool. So, according to Barna, 1 in 3 Christians stopped attending church after the pandemic. That's 33%. I'm sure you guys know someone. 68% of church-going men and over 50% of pastors view porn on a regular basis. Of young Christian adults, 18 to 24 years old, 76% actively search for porn. Less than 20% of churchgoers read their Bible daily. Americans who identify as Christians, a majority of U.S. Christians, 54%, now say that homosexuality should be accepted rather than discouraged by society. This has grown 10% since Pew Research did this study in 2007. I think we got one more. Yeah. Which religions lead to eternal life? This was also Pew Research in 2008, so I'm sure it's gotten worse by then. 69% said other religions lead to eternal life as well. So we should take that into heart and show that we really hate the world. So I'm going to read this passage, and then I'll pray, and then we'll get started. So James 4 through 10. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is no perfect, as the scripture says, he yearns jealously over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives more grace. Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Let's pray. Father, I pray for this time, God. I pray that you will use the time I've spent preparing this message, that you will open hearts, God. Only you can do that. You can turn this message into a great message, God. I pray that people will take this to heart, God, that we will realize how much we love the world and that we need to flee to you, God. Help people have an eternal perspective. I know I may not be the greatest speaker, but I pray that they will look to you instead of looking at me. I pray that you'll be glorified in all this, in Christ's name. Amen. So I'm starting out with some context. In verse 1 through 3, he's talking about our evil desires and heart, which leads to arguments within the church. This is because of a mix of believers and many other things that are happening. Also, at the end of verse 2 and in verse 3, he's talking about how when we pray, all we care about is us. When we pray, we ask wrongly. As James puts it, we ask wrongly to spend it on our passions. This is where he goes into the verse 3, showing how the Christians are in love with the world and what God's response is and what ours should be. So the three subpoints of this message are adultery, jealousy, and humility. Or you could broaden that out and say spiritual adultery, God's jealousy, and our response, humility. In verse 4, it says, you adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Spiritual adultery is quite simply unfaithfulness to God. It is having an undue fondness for the things of this world. We have a covenant with God as his children. Just as married people have a covenant to be wed all of their days, we, the church, have a covenant with God. We, in a spiritual sense, are cheating on God, who is always faithful. Not only are we okay with the things of this world, but we love them. When you're truly good friends with someone, you love them, or at least you should. So what is the world that he's referring to in verse 4? He says, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? So what is he referring to? The biblical concept of world falls into five categories. The physical world, the human world, the moral world, the temporal world, and the coming world. James 4:4 could fall into any of these four categories, but the one I would say it falls under the most is the moral world. However, this world is not the least bit moral. As Martin Lloyd-Jones said, nice, that's so cool. Okay, the most ethical man in the world is in the same position as the wife beater or the drunkard. So, we have today in our culture love for so many things that God hates. Look at our music, for instance. It is absolutely terrible. Today's rap is all about sex, drugs, or suicide. Should Christians be listening to this type of music? By no means. Look at the music you listen to and answer for yourself whether or not this is glorifying God. I have a feeling a majority of you would say no. Also, today's culture wholeheartedly approves such things as homosexuality, abortion, transgenderism, and just has a total lack of fear for God. So many times in today's culture, we compare ourselves to the next person. We think, compared to that person, I'm not too bad. If you lined yourself up with someone like Hitler or Stalin or Saddam Hussein, you'd look like a really great moral person. But God is not judging your sin off others. On Judgment Day, you'll be judged by His perfect moral law, the Ten Commandments. And to just break one of these means you're guilty in front of a holy God. For we can't be in His perfect presence in our sin. This is the beauty of the cross. We can and will be sinners, and yet can be accepted in His eternal kingdom through the righteousness of Christ alone. Not by anything we have done, but by His grace alone. If you believe in the work that He accomplished through His word and on the cross, and repent and turn away from your sins, you will be saved from condemnation. Are you daily being an enemy or a hater of God? Just self-evaluate and answer this question for yourselves. Are you accepting the things of this world, or are you listening to Christ and being what He has called you to be, which is set apart from the world? As it says in Romans 12:2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that through testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. So let's say you have a humongous Tennessee fan. Anybody in here a humongous Tennessee fan? Jackson. Jackson wins. So he watches every game, season tickets, goes to the game, face paint, all that stuff. Then you go to a Tennessee-Florida game, you see him cheering for the Gators. How can you invest it in two things in complete opposition to each other? It just doesn't make sense. If you really care and are dedicated to one, you will hate the other. Jeremy Pruitt wants you to be on his team instead of Muschamp's team. God wants you to be on His team instead of the team of the enemy. So this goes into God's jealousy. Just like Jeremy Pruitt is jealous for your being a fan of his team, God wants you to be a player for His team. So in verse 5 it says, or do you suppose it is no purpose that the scripture says, He yearns jealously over the spirit that He has made dwell in us. So what does he mean by He yearns jealously over the spirit? The spirit he is referring to is not the Holy Spirit, for He does not dwell in all men. He's talking about the human spirit. God doesn't want you half in and half out. He is a jealous God. God wants all of you. You can only serve one master. Are you fully devoted to God, or are you serving your master, Satan? God has made you. Would you not want something that you have made? If you made money at a job and someone took it, would it not be just for you to want your money that you have worked hard for and earned by yourself? Of course it would be. The same is true with God. And He is grieved to see the world in all its sin, just as you would be if someone stole your hard-earned money. In Exodus 34:14 it says, for the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. The passion of jealousy in man is usually exercised in an evil manner, but it is not in itself necessarily sinful. All thoughtful persons will agree that there is such a thing as virtuous jealousy. Self-love is no doubt the usual foundation of human jealousy. Charles Spurgeon. Perhaps a practical example will help. If a husband sees another man flirting with his wife, is he not right to be jealous? For only he can flirt with his wife. But this type of jealousy is not sinful. Rather, it is entirely appropriate. Being jealous for something that God declares to belong to you is good and appropriate. When is jealousy a sin? Jealousy is a sin when it is a desire for something that does not belong to you. Worship, praise, honor, and adoration belong to God alone, for only He is truly worthy of it. Therefore, God is rightly jealous when worship, praise, honor, and adoration is given to idols. This is precisely the jealousy the Apostle Paul describes in 2 Corinthians 11:2, where he says, I am jealous for you with a godly jealous. So what should our response be to God's jealousy? We see in verse 4 that we hate God and we love the world. We see in verse 5 that God is jealous over his creation. So our response should be, in verse 6 through 10, humility. As it says in 6 through 10, but he gives more grace. Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. So we are spiritually dead in our sin, and our only hope is God's grace. What he means by more grace is referring to his gracious power over the flesh and the world. God's grace is greater than our adultery. While we are continually unfaithful to him, he is always faithful to us. We cannot rescue ourselves. We are utterly hopeless without Christ. If you try to stop sinning on your own, you will continually fail. We must humble ourselves and give our struggles to the one who can and has power over these sins. God loves humility. He gives grace to the humble, not the proud. So give up and give in and submit to Jesus. You cannot fix your problems. If you try to lift 1,000 pounds by yourself, first of all, that'd be extremely foolish, and you wouldn't even try it because you know that you can't. But if one of the world's strongest men, or Matt Dixon, came over to you, you would let him help because he has proven that he can lift this. The same is true with God. He's proven that he alone can fix your sinful nature. Apart from him, you can do nothing. John 15:5 says, I'm the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Humble yourself and let God. Salvation begins with humility, realizing you are in need of a Savior. Okay, let's say you go over to a buddy's house. You just start doing awful things to him. You lie to his face, steal his money, kick his dogs, etc. Then you're climbing up a mountain and trip and fall and are hanging off a cliff. And there's Mr. Buddy standing right there to help you. So he reaches out his arm and you don't want to grab on because of your pride. But to not let him save you would be completely foolish and would end in your death. So you then humble yourselves and he picks you up and saves you and sacrifices his life after all that you did to him. What would we do? Let us imitate God. No one has ever done anything bad enough to us where we can't still give them grace and mercy. Christ was killed, and yet he still shows grace and mercy. Let us imitate God in this way. So therefore, since you can't do anything apart from the grace of God, submit yourself to him and resist the devil or sin, and it will flee from you. This is the beauty of salvation. Submit literally means to line up under. James is talking about a willing, conscious submission, realizing that God is the sovereign authority over all things. Resist means to take a stand. All people are either under the worship of God or of Satan. Flee is an action verb, meaning to run away from a place or a situation of danger. It is something you must do. It requires you to run. As a lot of people over time have said, sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. Sin looks appealing at first, but it only leads to more and more sin and terrible consequences. Who in here likes Twinkies? Mark wins this time. Okay, so you go to a gas station, you pick out a Twinkie, you open it up, looks so good, you take a bite, and it's filled with mayo. The same is true as sin. You take a bite in this and you realize how awful and terrible it is. It looked good at first, but it led to terrible consequences because no one likes mayo. While you are running from your sin and fleeing from the devil, you are drawing near to God. Pursue an intimate relationship with him. Read daily his word, for this is how he speaks to you. As John MacArthur said, salvation involves more than submitting to God and resisting the devil. The redeemed heart longs communion with God. When we draw near to God, we must recognize and confess our sin. We must recognize who we are drawing near to. Cleansing your hands refers to an external behavior. We must now walk in a way according to the word of God, which would in turn purify our hearts. We are such double-minded people. One second we love God, and the next we love our sin so much more. As Charles Spurgeon said, Periodical godliness is perpetual hypocrisy. Don't be a hypocrite. As it says in 1 John 4:20, if anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. In Luke 12:2, it says, nothing is covered up that will not be revealed or hidden that will not be known. You may be able to hide your hypocrisy now from everyone, but God knows your heart. So why would James tell us to mourn and weep? Is this not contradictory to everything we know as Christians? Is this not contradictory to us being joyful? James is referring to the state someone is in when they see their sin. We will truly be brokenhearted, realizing that we have grieved the only one who has loved us perfectly and even died for us. Mourning is the inner response to such brokenness, while weeping is the outward manifestation of the inner sorrow of our sin. In this culture, we have grown so immune to sin, we do not take it seriously anymore. Sin is so serious that it is an abomination to the Lord and will damn the sinner for all of eternity. James is talking to such people. They give no thought to God. They have no fear for him. I pray that you guys will understand God's power and fear him, for this is the beginning of wisdom. Once you see sin as God sees it, you will no longer laugh at the horrible things you once laughed at or do the things you once did. Salvation results in a change of heart and lifestyle. Fearing God means you hate sin. What does humble mean? Humble means to make oneself low, not putting yourself down, but realizing who is so much higher than you, and that you are small and unholy and sinful compared to Almighty God. Humility shows that you fear God. As it says in Matthew 23:12, whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. In 1 Peter 5:6, it says, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. As R.C. Sproul once said, we focus far too much attention on ourselves and not merely enough on the majesty of God. In C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity, he referred to humility as the great sin. As he said in his book, pride leads to every other vice. It is a complete anti-God state of mind. He also said, a proud man is always looking down on things and people. And of course, as long as you're looking down, you cannot see anything that is above you. The gospel is not about you. It is about the story of sinful man and their rebellion against God. And that Almighty God, being just, perfect, and holy, sent his son to die where we should have. Humble yourself. Stop making the gospel about us and realize that it's completely and totally for the glory of God. As it says in Chronicles 29:11, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. In conclusion, we are haters of God and are spiritual adulterers toward God, and in turn, he is jealous over his creation. So what must we do? We must humble ourselves, flee from our sin, and flee to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, I pray that they will open their hearts, God. You will open their hearts, and they will see their sin as you see it, God. I pray that we will humble ourselves before you and realize that you alone are holy and worthy to save. Father, I just pray that we will see the beauty in the gospel and that we will want to read your word daily. We will hate the things of the world. We will see you as glorious because you truly are. I pray that we will humble ourselves and realizing that we're just mere humans here for a little while, but you are eternal Father who can save. So let us humble ourselves, for this is the beginning of wisdom. Thank you for this time, and thank you for this opportunity you've given me. In Christ's name, amen.